I'm gonna try my best. It's hard to change after a long time. We'll be in Matthew chapter 10 this morning. So if you have your Bibles, you want to open there. I'm going to go through some highlights. Can't go through the whole chapter. It would take a long time. But just remember, when Jesus was born, we started this journey at Christmas. And I felt the Holy Spirit lead me to follow Jesus. And I didn't know what that meant. I didn't even know what it meant for my own life. I'm starting to learn, Lord. I feel like I'm just starting, God, so thank you for that. So when Jesus was born, that's when his kingdom came, started to be established, right? It continued. It's continuing. And how he lived and taught, he came bringing the kingdom, and one day fully manifest and totally, right? So we're part of this now, and it's here, and man. So he's preached on the mountain. We've been through that. You had the Beatitudes and the Sermon on the Mount. Basically teaching us how we're supposed to live, how our hearts should be, right? Sharing really how this kingdom of God is different than the world's kingdoms. And remember, to the Jews, we have to think in the Jewish context if we can. I know it's hard, but we have to try that. How the Old Testament law is fulfilled. The law and the prophets. Everything is fulfilled now in this. So he comes down off the mountain after all of this teaching, which you can go back. It's good to read. If you're in the one-year Bible, we're all in Matthew anyway, so you should be learning that. If you don't make it a practice of reading daily and going through the Bible, every year you should go through the Bible. Nobody has an excuse not to, except you just don't want to because you think it's boring. But powerful. Even if you live 100 years, you're gonna have a lot more to learn. So he comes down off the mountain. He said a whole lot. Comes down off the mountain. Now he backs up all his word that he just said about the kingdom with his authority and power. About 12, some say 10, but it's actually like 12. 12 miracles. So it's broken up. He backs it up with action. He proves his authority. Miracles over sickness, demons, nature, forgiving sins. So we're going to begin in chapter 10 this morning. It's a very important beginning to a chapter, but we are in actually chapter 10. If you don't know, if you haven't been here, is the second discourse, the second block of teaching of 5 blocks of teaching in Matthew. Why is that? Is that important? Are you just reading into that? Is that, no, this is a reality. Because this is we call it the Torah of Jesus. Matthew is writing this, Jewish Matthew is writing this with a purpose in mind, and he has these Jewish gems hidden in there. Which I have to explain to you, but if we were Jewish, we would have already understood. That's how the text is divided. So here is how we can see the 5 divisions, and they already put it up there. Whenever you see these words, and so it was, or now it came to pass when Jesus finished speaking, or the sayings, or the parables, there's your marker for the discourse. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Go home and check it out later, highlight it, and then you have the those five things. Is it going to make you more spiritual? No. But if you're Jewish, you'll understand, oh, I see. Jesus' teaching is... Okay, so let's start in chapter 10. Jesus called his 12 disciples to him and gave them authority to drive out impure spirits and heal every disease and sickness. These are the names of the 12 apostles. First, Simon, who is called Peter, and his brother Andrew. James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John. Philip and Bartholomew. Thomas and Matthew, the tax collector. James, son of Alphaeus, and Thaddeus. Where are you, Thad? Are you here? Thad, you're in the Bible. I thought of you when I read that. Simon the Zealot and Judas Iscariot, who betrayed him. These 12 Jesus sent out with the following instructions. Do not go among the Gentiles or enter any town of the Samaritans. Go rather to the lost sheep of Israel. As you go, proclaim this message. The kingdom of heaven has come near. Heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse those who have leprosy, drive out demons. Freely you have received, freely give. Actually, let's go right before. Go before in your Bible. Let's get some more context, because in Matthew 9:36, where this is coming from, but when he saw the multitudes, he was moved with compassion for them because they were weary and scattered like sheep having no shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, the harvest truly is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, pray to the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest. And then right from that, it's time to delegate this authority. It's time to start a mission. Out of compassion, he sees all the suffering and hurting people. He's with all these multitudes. And he sees this harvest of souls. Needs workers from the Lord of harvest. So chapter 10 really starts with the answer to that. The beginnings of the answer to that prayer that's eventually going to go. So notice in chapter 10, before these workers are even named, Matthew says Jesus called them, and Jesus gave them authority. That's before their names are mentioned, because there's nothing special about them. It's going to come from his power and his authority first, and this will be repeated. Everything that was about to happen, that did happen, came from Jesus' authority. Verse 2, you see the name disciple changed to apostle. In the Greek, it's simply from student to a special ambassador. And here we have, for the first time, because up till now, they've only been called disciples. This is the first time where we see this, the 12 apostles, the original 12 apostles. And if you notice, if you're looking in your Bibles, when you see repetition in the Bible, it's important. Pay attention, use your highlighters, actually study the thing. Just like any other piece of literature, when we repeat things, it's to drive a point. And there's specific things in the Bible. Not all, but specific things that are repeated for a reason. So we see here, notice how many times Matthew says 12. He says three times in five verses. He says 12. Jesus calls 12, names of the 12, these 12. We get the point. Why is he driving that home? Because it's a Jewish audience. And they're going to relate that 12 to the 12 tribes of Israel. He's saying this is the new Israel, the kingdom people, carrying out what God wanted all along, his people to spread his glory amongst the whole earth, for all people to be saved, for this message to be spread to the nations across the world, not just based on one ethnicity or roots. wow, Lord, help me. I feel opposition from this. There shouldn't be, so bear with me. Israel is God's chosen people. In Christ, we are all God's chosen people. Okay? This means we are Israel too. The true Israel, right? Not replacement theology. And you go look that up later. We're not talking about that. Grafted in, but it's not any less than, right? Guess what? Israel still needs evangelism. That's still a mission field. They don't get a get out of jail free card just because their parents are Jewish. Do we understand this? See, this feels controversial because we have mixed up things in our minds about stuff based on bad theology or other things. So what I'm saying is Israel does not have some special luxury that makes them saved by not turning to Christ. Are you following me? There are some wacky teachings out there, ladies and gentlemen. I can't filter them all for you. You need to figure it out with the Word of God. But if you follow the kingdom through the Bible, you're going to figure out that in Christ, we're all as much as a child of Abraham as somebody who's born Jewish. Does that make sense? Okay. You guys good with that? I'm not being anti-Semitic or anything, right? Okay. So we're not worshiping an ethnicity. That was never the point. And Matthew 3:9, right? Jesus is like, oh, you're a child of Abraham? Big deal. I can get these stones to be children of Abraham. I can get that girl on the piano to be a child of Abraham. And me and you. That's what he's saying. So now we have these 12 Jewish apostles. 12, it's important. Matthew lists he lists them, and in the Greek you see it especially, three sets of four, six pairs of two, because they're about to be sent out two by two. And they're not really super important guys. I mean, to us they are because they're in the Bible, but half of them we don't even know anything about. You can see the descriptions, and this is what you know about some of them. You know the first four, and in every list through the Bible, in the Gospels, Peter's always first. And then you have these first four, not always in the same order, but Peter's always first. Remember in the boat, these are the first four that were called. So they're listed there. And James is sometimes left out there. Then you have Matthew, the one writing this, a tax collector. We'll get into that. And then you have the last two are a strange pair, because you have Simon the Zealot, and that means he's a political revolutionist or nationalist, right? And then you have Judas, the betrayer. Simon, he was the guy who he had his sword ready, or he's armed, he's ready to go. He's like, we're bringing the kingdom, let's do this. We're going to bring war. We're going to take care of these guys. Really excited. You had fishermen, common men, not famous or well-known guys. A tax collector, we don't realize, how would a tax collector be looked at by a Jew? That's hard for us to grasp unless we study history. I don't hate all IRS agents. Some of them have been nice to me on the phone after I wait for 6 hours on hold. And I don't trust them for the most part. This is far worse than your perception of the IRS. How Jews saw tax collectors was probably worse than lepers. They were traitors. They sold out to the man, to Rome. They were defiled. There was no restoration for them. That's why Matthew even, this is a miracle in itself, Matthew being converted. And that's because Jesus, the Jews saw them as outcasts. What did Jesus see them as? People needing healing. Jesus gave his power to these guys. Wow. And we can learn a few things of what we are supposed to do after we decide we respond to the call to follow Jesus. Matthew 10, 5 through 6. We'll continue there. These 12 Jesus sent out and commanded them, saying, "Do not go into the way of the Gentiles and do not enter the city of the Samaritans, but go rather to the lost sheep of Israel." So this morning, the first point would be start where you are. This is, by the way, this whole discourse is mission. And the outcome of it at the end, we're going to find out what we have to look forward to. So Jesus says, stick to the Jewish people. Don't go to the Gentiles. Which for them, they would have expected that. They would have been fine. They wouldn't have been saying, "Well, no, let's go reach those outside." They're not in that mindset yet. This was also practical, theological and practical, because they're all Jewish. They already know the language. They already know the history. They know the Torah. So this is an open door. They wouldn't have to say, let me tell you about Moses and how it connects to this. Let me tell you about Abraham. We have to do that. We have to learn that. Some of us are still learning. We don't have all that. We're not raised that way if we're not Jewish. But even in their house or their tribe, there were these lost sheep. Now, is this call to go to the Jews first right here, is that for us? Somebody say no. No, that's not specifically for us. So all of these instructions don't apply to us. And we can see that we'll get to the end, verse 28, we'll get there. We're called to go to all the nations. All! Not just one, all. The principle is that we should start where God has sent us. And which right now, I guess, is where you are right now in this room, in your seat. And wherever you work, and your job, or how about your homes, or... those are the places that you already have influence. Why not just start there? Here in Northwest Iowa, so many people want to run out to the missions field. Overseas, guess what you have to do overseas? If it's not a short-term mission trip and you don't have a guide, you have to go to language school. You have to learn the culture, how they live. And then you start to have the ability to enter in. And it's just not as glamorous as people think. And many people want that, but they haven't even attempted to. How about start with your next door neighbors? That's a good start. If you're on a farm somewhere, wherever the next one is. There's somebody. We're not like Wyoming or wherever that unpopulated Montana, or I don't know, whatever. I think it's Wyoming. We have a mission field right here. Church, if you don't think we have a mission field in Northwest Iowa, I challenge you, and I will, I think I can make the time to do this. You can call me tomorrow. I'll take you in my little car, and I'll show you where all the mission field is right now, where there's people for you to reach for the kingdom, because it's here. Start where you are until Jesus actually sends you somewhere else. Okay, well then what do? Well, the Bible tells us what to do. What do we say? The Bible tells us what to say. We got it all right here. It's awesome. I love it. So number two is we're going to say and do what Jesus did. We're going to say and do what Jesus said and did. Verse 7 says, here it is. As you go, preach, saying the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Heal the sick, cleanse the lepers, raise the dead, cast out demons. Freely have you received, freely give. You're going to proclaim the good news. You're going to proclaim the kingdom, the gospel. Saying what he said about the kingdom in a way that the people in your influence are going to understand. We're not going to pull out our King James and just shout at the top of our lungs, "Thee is thou receivest the wrath of God," or whatever. That's not going to work. We have language. We have whatever a North Iowa accent is. I don't think there is such a thing, but we have the ability to do that. So God's already given us that. Jesus had just spent all this time, look at all these pages, red letter, red letter, red letter, speaking all the red letters for a reason. And at that time, these Jewish apostles, they knew enough to explain how following this new radical teaching is going to fulfill the Old Testament law and prophet. What do we have now? We have more than that. We have everything. The full gospel. It's right here. These guys would have been like, wow, you guys have all this? And even what Matthew the tax collector wrote? And man, that was, I can't even believe he got to write a book in the Bible. And what are you guys doing with it? We have a message of hope for all people. All people. The death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. A new life, new creation, hope in a future. And all we need to say is right here. So we also have to do what Jesus did. So chapters 5-7 is the words. And then 8-9, you're going to see the deeds. And those deeds, that covers a whole bunch. He healed the sick, raised the dead, cleansed lepers, and cast out devils. He asked us to do that? Yeah, what does that mean? I mean, really, if you read, the apostles, they never raised the dead until after the resurrection. It was Tabitha and Eutychus, right? It's more than that. Sick, yes, absolutely, physically sick, but in the Greek, actually, right there, it means weak and feeble. So it's also talking about weak. Raising the dead, yeah, that means spiritually dead. What good are you coming back to life if you're not saved? This is the message we're proclaiming. And then lepers, not only the diseased, where I believe in the power of God for healing, but I'm going to the people that no one else wants to touch. That's what Jesus did. And he prayed for them. And he spent time with them. Power over demonic oppression. Oh, Lord, we need a lot of help with that. The people who are bound in the most sin are the most demonically oppressed. And what is our goal? To set them free. But the deeds are not just praying for people, not just laying hands on people. The whole thing is we have to spend our precious American time, actually spend time with people to minister to them. And time is precious. It's borderline, if not idolatry to us. And we're all guilty of it in some way or another fashion. When our time has become so important to us. To take time and spend it with those who are outcasted, with those who are off, who those are weak, be it sickness, deemed less than. And that's because that is the mission that Jesus came showing us and preaching and doing. That's his mission. It's his mission because it's who he is. This is who Jesus is. Who is Jesus? I think I'm understanding more. Because we say, oh yeah, I know Jesus, but do we? Do we know Jesus? How do we know him? What Jesus said and what he did, guess what? That's Jesus' identity. That helps us know what his identity. Why does it lead to that? Because what you do and what you say and what you do is going to lead me to understand who you are. Am I right? That's a principle. Who is that person? I don't know. Let me hear what they say. Let me see what they do. Let me spend time with them. Okay, I have a good idea of who they are. If I'm looking at what you do and I'm listening to what you say, I'm going to have a good idea of your identity. Jesus' identity, out of that, it led to his accomplishments. His greatest accomplishments are the cross and resurrection. That's what his identity led to. His accomplishments, the cross and the resurrection, that leads to our identity in him. Track with me, if you can. It's not that our identity my watch was calling someone. Sorry about that. I think it was calling Pastor Renee over at Trinity Lutheran. Okay, Lord, whatever that is, I pray for Pastor Renee. Bless her, anoint her as she preaches this morning in Jesus' name. Good lady. Let me back up. So Jesus' accomplishments, because of the cross and resurrection, leads to our identity in him. That's who we are in Christ. Okay. Our identity in him leads to our works. It is not that our works as Christians lead to our identity. This is the Christian life. The problem is that in many churches, I want to say most churches, and at some point in my life and all of our lives, do you know what we do? We start with our works to define our identity as a Christian. What we say, what we do, how we look, how we act, and then we define who we are by what we do, and then we end up defining, actually we end up defining Jesus by what we do as Christians. And that's scary. That's actually backwards, because this is different. You've been grafted into the kingdom of God now as a Christian. If you want to know what your works are and your deeds are, you look at Jesus. You look at Jesus first. So if you ask people, what does it mean to be a Christian? What's the answer that you usually get? Well, I go to church and I pray and I fast and I do my devotionals and I live a good life. Just some standard answers, right? Prayer life, we put that up, really important. Reading the Bible, things like that. Of course, church attendance and tithing you could throw in there. But what did Jesus do? Primarily. What is he known for? He ate with sinners. He went to the outcasted people and healed them. He set people free from demonic powers. Those are the things he's primarily known for. Yes, of course he prayed and did all these other things, but that's not what his entire identity is wrapped up in. Is it his devotional time? That's who Jesus is. No. What made Jesus who he is what he said and what he did with the least of these, which I believe at some point was all of us. So look at what Jesus is known for, and then here's how you figure it out, your identity now in him. Because it's not in you, it's in him. Look at what Jesus is known for. And those should be the same things that you're known for. If it's not, something's wrong. If you're not saying what Jesus said and doing, if we're not, we're supposed to be saying what Jesus said and doing what he did. Do you mean verbatim? No. I hope you're not taking it that way. Like you have to walk around reciting the exact. Be what he was about. This is the kingdom. This is the mission. Well, are you saying we can preach the kingdom and set people free like Jesus? Even heal people and cast out demons? Yes, that's what I'm saying. Well, that sounds hard. Of course it is. It's very hard because you're not going to do it on your own. And that's the next point. It's rely on him. Matthew 10, verse 9. We'll go there. Okay. Here we go. Do not get any gold or silver or copper to take with you in your belts. No bag for the journey or extra shirt or sandals or a staff, for the worker is worth his keep. So, I think it's called mnemonics. Numbers are important in the Bible. It's all over. I'm not talking about some secret code. I'm not talking about some esoteric knowledge that we have. But especially with Jewish people, numbers are important. And they're here for a reason. So when we count, first let's just count the number of items we have here. 1, 2, gold, silver, copper, bag, extra shirt. Some say 2 tunics, but it means an extra shirt because they wore 2 for luxury. Sandals and a staff. That's 7, right? 7. Not a big deal to us. We don't think about it, but to Jewish people, it is a big deal. And that's why Matthew's writing this different than the other accounts, which these scholars are like arguing about over really dumb things. And they're questioning the infallibility of Scripture, rather. But to the Jewish reader, numerically orientated, 7 is completion. We know that. Basically, it's saying this, without getting off into the weeds, they were supposed to be completely unprepared for what they were about to do because they had to be completely reliant on God to do what they're about to do, this mission. That's what it means. They are putting into action what we learned, I don't know how many weeks ago. I've slept since then. The do not worry one with the lilies, right? They're putting into action what he just preached. Don't worry, I'm going to provide for you. And now we're going to put this to the test. Don't even prepare. Just be completely dependent on me. And this is what we're going to do. Rely on him. Trust him. Remember the boat? That was last week. You think he's not going to get you through the storm when he called you into the boat? Trust. Reliance. It's the opposite of self-reliance and this self-love thing that we have. Self-reliance in our world is just, it's a plague. It's in like every animated cartoon my kids watch now. I have to, it's so subtle. We're not even talking about sexual sins and all that. We're talking about just depending on your own strengths. This is the kingdom of God where we depend on his strength. So for them, literally, so this isn't, that's not for us. Are you saying, why am I here with shoes right now? No, this is for these 12 apostles at this specific time. Because Jesus was going to show them how he was going to provide. And he did. Later on, and this changes, of course, the call, the command, but the principle is the same. We prepare physically. Thank the Lord. You all have tunics on and shoes and all that. But we're still relying on Jesus. We're still trusting on his power. Not ours. That's what faith is about. So after this, just move on. Jesus talks about letting our peace rest upon the houses and then shaking the dust off our feet, right? So just quickly on that, being a peace bearer at that time was significant for where they were. Jesus lived in the time of Roman rule, Pax Romana, which basically, it just means Roman peace. And that means that Rome, they believe that the gods gave them the power to give peace and take away peace. Okay, imagine being that under that kind of government. So they claim to be the agents of the gods. This is Rome. And how did they bring peace? They brought peace by slaughtering their opponents, crucifying their opponent, right? This is what they did. That's their version of peace because they claim to be the agents of the gods. So Jesus is saying this because his agents, his followers, are going to administer real peace, not peace like the political system of the time. So we have to understand that too. And the only way, I guess, you can do that is by studying history. Jesus was saying it's not going to be by force. Did Christians get that wrong in history at some time? I think so. That's not how we do this. And Simon the Zealot, he's hearing this, ready to go. He's going to enforce peace, right? He had a lot to learn, and we'll get to that by the end. But there was a fight coming, just not the one that we think, and that's what happens with missions. And this is what we need to expect this morning if we're really going to do this. If we're really going to stop defining our Christianity by what we do and define it by what Jesus did. Not by what we say, but by what he said. You're going to, number four, just expect this. Expect persecution. It is going to happen. It is not an if, it's a when you are persecuted. Jesus goes on, and then we have this big section at the end of 10. It's all about persecution. And he says you're being sent out like sheep among wolves. Which basically means trouble is waiting for you. And don't go looking for a fight or trouble. You don't have to. It's just going to come to you. So be careful. Be shrewd. Be wise. For those of us who like fights or like getting into fights. Matthew 10:24, the student is not above the teacher, nor a servant above his master. It is enough for students to be like their teachers and servants like their masters. If the head of the house has been called Beelzebub, how much more the members of his own household? If they persecuted Jesus and treated him like a devil, how much more are they going to persecute us, members of his family? Expect it. It's going to happen. How do we react to that? 2024 Americans, how do we react to that? Well, let's look for what is repeated again in Scripture. I'll read the verses and then see if in your minds you see a phrase highlighted. Good way to study the Bible if you want to learn hermeneutics is look for these things. Verse 26, so do not be afraid of them, for there is nothing concealed that will not be disclosed or hidden that will not be made known. What I tell you in the dark, speak in the daylight. What is whispered in your ear, proclaim from the roofs. Do not be afraid of those who kill the body but cannot kill the soul. Rather be afraid of the one who can destroy both soul and body in hell. Are not two sparrows sold for a penny? Yet not one of them will fall to the ground outside of your Father's care, and even the very hairs of your head are all numbered. So don't be afraid. You are worth more than the many sparrows. You see the repeat? Three times. Don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. don't be afraid. We get it? The worst Satan can do is kill your body. That's the worst. The worst any man can do is kill your body. There's nothing to fear. It's a command. Don't be afraid. We're sons and daughters of God. We're worth more than a sparrow for whatever. Pennies. And Satan doesn't deserve our fear. He doesn't deserve it. At all. He works through fear. He works through violence, which is murder. And he works through isolation. You think of those, the guys possessed with the demon who are like in caves by themselves for so long. Fear, violence, either that you will kill someone else or kill yourself, and isolation. Isolation is one that I'm starting to get more now. With all my struggles of mental illness and my social anxiety and that pull in me to stay isolated from humanity, I'm starting to learn Satan really likes to operate that way. Because when you're isolated, nobody cares about me, nobody loves me, God doesn't love me, I'm all alone, and he's got you where he wants you. These are just some of the ways he operates, and you don't have to be afraid of how he operates in the kingdom of God. Because Jesus just said it 3 times, don't be afraid, don't be afraid, don't be afraid. Verse 34. Do not suppose that I have come to bring peace on earth. I did not come to bring peace, but a sword. So if you think that, or if you've been taught or you believe that that verse somehow is Jesus telling you that it's okay for you to go out and commit violent acts, you're just misinterpreting scripture. I'm just telling you. Remember the Pax Romana, the Romans? They claimed to bring peace by killing with swords. And their peace was a sham. This is what their peace looked like. That doesn't look very peaceful to me. Just like the world's peace, it's a sham. World peace, not going to happen. Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. I do not give you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled and do not be afraid. John 14:27. But Jesus says he's not bringing peace. He's bringing the sword. And Simon the Zealot's getting excited. Yes! What is the sword? Is the sword my Ruger LCP380 that's in my nightstand right now next to a Bible? No, that's not the sword that he's talking about. The sword is the message of the kingdom. That is the sword. The word of God, us following Jesus' deeds, words, identity, and the great mission that is going to cause division in your life. That's why it's a sword. In your families, that's what Jesus is saying. That's why in Revelation 19:15 it says, from his mouth comes a sharp sword. Is that literal? No. It's the message. This message divides people. Some of us have already experienced it. I know I have. It causes wars. It gets people killed. But who are the ones getting killed and who's killing? It's us who are getting killed for the gospel and persecuted. We aren't the killers. And I've done it before. And Lord, thank you for being merciful with me. You can take words, ladies and gentlemen, in the Bible. And if you look at sword all throughout the Bible, if you think that sword means sword physical sword every single time it's used, you're just disobeying laws of context that we use in all other literature that we use in real life. Where's my wife? I can't use her as an example. I will. I'll pretend she's right there. If my wife was right there and I just said, honey, I love you very much. In fact, come here and give me a kiss and a hug. And then if I go to Drew, hey, Drew, what's up, bro? I love you. Did love mean the same thing for both of those? No, it did not. It's a different context. I don't love Drew like I love my wife. That's very strange. I'm not going there. So why would we do that with the Bible? Because it's easier not to, I guess it's easier just not to study the context. And take whatever somebody told you as, because it'll line up with what you wanted to believe. And that's the danger, right? That's why we have all these warnings against false teachers and false teaching. So this message that we're living and proclaiming, it's going to possibly get us killed one day. This is the message of the kingdom. It's going to cause division. That's why Jesus is saying he came bringing the sword. Hebrews 4:12, here's the sword, the evidence of the sword. For the word of God is alive and powerful. It's sharper than the sharpest two-edged sword, cutting between the soul and spirit, between joint and marrow. It exposes our innermost thoughts and desires. That's it. Nobody wants their innermost thoughts and desires exposed. What are we going to find in there? What is the Bible going to reveal about us? I don't know that there's no one righteous and we're just desperately sinful and in need of a savior. Maybe a little bit embarrassing and shameful, but there's a message of hope and restoration that comes out of that. But people are uncomfortable with being revealed or open. And that's what the word of God comes to do. And that's what we're presenting. We're using the gospel to look at people's hearts and reveal their innermost intents and offer transformation. Where you go from being ashamed to restored. Now, when you actually start doing what Jesus did and saying what he said, that includes all of it. That means being public. Proclaim is a public word. Now, how you do it is that's a personal way, right? But talking about Jesus, talking about the kingdom in your conversations, in your workplaces, wherever you go, yes, praying for people in public, why not? I know we've talked about, of course, not everyone gets healed all the time, but I believe less people get healed simply because we don't pray for people. We just take a break. We just kind of give up on that. Well, if he's not going to heal, then what's the point? No. This is what we do. We pray, Lord, set them free. For what goal? Just that they're physically healed? No, that they're under your kingdom. Carolyn talked about it. She preached the message before I even started. Hanging out with vile sinners. The unclean or dirty. The people who smell. The people who are mentally tormented and disturbed. It's easy to hang around stable, loving people, isn't it? All you're all stable and loving. It's easy to hang around you, but what about this mission field out here? We have a mental health crisis. We have a drug addiction crisis. We have a fentanyl crisis. You want to wait for a government to take care of it? When the perfect government is right here, already operating in us to see people set free, it's a whole new political system. That's what they didn't understand. Because they were expecting Jesus just, we're going to force everyone out of here, set everything up perfect, and everyone who's not Jewish stays on the outside. That's how we're going to do it. No. This is completely unexpected. And I think it still is. And then we're going to those people, and we're going to love them. Whatever your definition of those people are. How about think of the person you hate the most That's radical to say in church. And then make it, pray to God that he helps you see them through his eyes. And then you'll spend time with them and talk to them. That's radical. Pretty sure that's what Jesus did. Now, when you do this, you're going to have a lot of scorn. Because this isn't the way the powers that be in the world still, probably similar to Rome in a lot of ways, but then I'd say Christians in general, or believers, and especially the religious. When you start taking your time not to do all the church programs and the spiritual disciplines, the things that we're supposed to do. I read my Bible 2 hours today. I prayed for an hour. I fasted for 21 days. When you start going out and spending time with the people who are nobody else wants to spend time with, the drug addicts, the people who may curse you out, the people who may attack you, the people who don't believe the same way you do about the world or politics or anything, go spend time with them and reach them. And you're going to find that even the people you thought you were close to, they're going to look at you like, oh, you're associating with them? Do you know what I mean? And it's happened to my family in this state, in this town. Accused of being a baby killer because I'm spending time with people for the kingdom of God. Because it was an association. You can process that and probably figure out what it means. Man, our own body's gonna persecute us? Yeah, even your own household. If they're not doing this work, we have to hang out with everyone that we wouldn't normally hang out with. That's what Jesus did. Oh, this is hard. The mission is here. Make no mistake, it's now. And if you don't feel ready, look, I'm not ready. I don't ever feel ready. All I can do is rely on him. There's nothing I can do. There's no amount of time you can earn or pray or fast. Carolyn, just come up, because if you're here, just play something. There's no amount of Christian work you can do to earn some kind of superpower to see people saved and set free and healed and delivered and all this. Remember where we started before the apostles were even called? What was it about from the start? Jesus gave them the authority. Jesus called them. And this is what he's calling us to do. We have to start doing what Jesus did, saying what Jesus said, and proclaiming his kingdom to this area that we're all called to right now. You're called here. You're called here. Clay, David, Sandy, all of you, Brenda, Craig, yes. No matter what the enemy is speaking to you, remember, you have nothing to fear. He has no authority in your mind, in your life. You have a mission. Wow. Randy, you're already doing it, but you got a lot more work to do. And he's strengthening you. Physically, mentally, emotionally, that's with your wife. Both of you, in Jesus' name. Souls saved. People's lives changed because we decided that we're tired of doing church as usual. That sounds good. That's what it's all about. It was never about us. Does that sound like a mission? Do you know that you're called to missions right now and you don't have to go overseas? There's people waiting for you to proclaim the kingdom to them, to lay hands on them, to talk to them, say, hey, what can I pray for you for? How can we pray? Let me pray. Let me tell you about Jesus. And for all of you who are still not professing your testimonies, I challenge you to start. If you've been set free of pornography, do not be ashamed that Jesus set you free to tell someone else about it. We keep our past so hidden as if it's our little secret idol, and then we're going to use it only when we deem it necessary. When God gave you that past that's been redeemed and restored for a purpose, and that's to reach someone under your influence. Just like the Jews had all that knowledge, right? That's your story. It's not your story. It's his story. And he wants to use it for his glory. Because when they hear you, oh, wow, you've been clean off meth for 5 years? What? What do you attribute that to? Was it therapy? Was it the counseling? Was it, well, those things help, but ultimately, it was Jesus. And let me tell you, if he can do this for me, he can do it for you. How is your marriage restored? I mean, you guys were a mess a few years ago. Why is it okay now? It's Jesus. Let me tell you about it. Let me tell you about his kingdom. This is what he did. This is awesome. Where do I start reading the Bible? Let me show you. Let's pray together. Let's start a Bible study. It's right here. Would you stand this morning?